Today, we're going to talk about the role of the consultant in rehabilitation medicine. And I'm very pleased to be able to say, next slide, please, that I'm joined by four colleagues who are listed there. Julian Harris, who's actually a consultant in rehab medicine, but he's titled a physical medicine and rehab consultant because that's the new style of that at the BSRM, as it's been changed its name now. He also trained in Canada, where PMR is the way in which that's done. Ben Townsend, who's a partner at Stewarts. So good afternoon, Ben. Anna Watkiss, senior case manager and the lead psychologist, and Dr. Inam High, who's a consultant in rehabilitation medicine down in Somerset, where we know a great deal about the paucity of rehabilitation expertise, but it's very thin on the ground. Can I just go to each of you just to sort of say good afternoon and introduce yourself, say a few words. Julian, perhaps you'd like to go first. You're on mute.
That's me, yeah, sorry, struggling. Yeah, so I'm very grateful to Ed and others for having arranged this. I'm a consultant, as you say, in physical medicine and rehabilitation. I've been working with the BSRM to change the name in the UK to physical and rehabilitation medicine. And that would be to reflect the international nature of our specialty and our broad oversight. And if I can add, just say one thing about our specialty and what draws me to the specialty and particularly draws me to work with NRC is that we are probably the last group of generalists who are truly specialist generalists in the UK, as all of these silos of very narrow interest have evolved in the medical profession. Rehab medicine has remained broad. And so that I think we offer a unique insight into a number of different aspects of a very complex patient's case who didn't just bang their head, but suffered internal organ injuries and broken bones and all those other things. So I think that's why sometimes I'm asked to offer an opinion on several other very complicated issues. And I think that makes us very special.
That's great, Julian. Thank you for that. Ben, can I just come to you quickly?
Introduce yourself. Sure. Ben Townsend, I'm a partner at Stewarts. I've worked in personal injury now for, good Lord, 28 years. I've seen a lot of changes in that time. I'm very excited to talk about the subject today. We just got started before we started broadcasting, as it was, and I was sorry that we didn't get to continue straight away. Looking forward to getting going.
All right, thanks, Ben. Anna, would you just say a few words of introduction, please?
Yeah, hello. So I am a clinical lead of a case management company. My background is psychology. I'm a chartered psychologist, and I've been in case management for actually the same amount of time as Ben has been a solicitor. So 28 years I've been in case management. And be interesting to talk today. I've worked with a lot of rehab consultants in terms of many of them generally being an inpatient. So it'd be interesting to take the chat wider.
Great. Thanks, Anna. Inam, perhaps introduce yourself. Thank you.
Name Inam. I am the one of the rehab consultants here in the southwest, relatively nice part of the country, obviously a bit biased, yes. So I've been here for about 25 years in Taunton. Yes, I think the specialty-wise, certainly it's a kind of specialty which sometimes competes against the big hitters like the cardiology and cancer and trauma, just as an overview, really. I think so it is, particularly training-wise, the updated curriculum, etc. It just shows that there are a lot of complexities involved in the training process as well. And it's one of the specialities where you always have to have an overview hat on all the time, every time. You can't let that go because any sort of one thing in the loop can affect the next one. So I think so it would be good to have a bit of a discussion sort of in an overall context.
Great. Great, thanks, Inam. That's lovely. We're returning to the slides now. Thank you. Just to introduce myself, the number 28 has come up already twice. Well, funnily enough, I've been a consultant in rehab medicine for 28 years as well. So there we are, quite a lot of accumulated experience. And in fact, I'm currently clinical director of neuro rehab for the County of Somerset. So Inam is one of my colleagues down there. And obviously I have a role at NRC Medical Experts, and both Julian and Inam are my colleagues there, with different hats on actually, and importantly, and Julian is very predominantly a medical legal expert orientated, and Inam is very much more clinical service, clinical practice orientated. And those are two distinctions that will hopefully come up in the dialogue. Okay, next slide, please. Thank you. So I'm just going to move this dialogue box so I can see the slide I'm talking to. Okay, you know, I've only got half a dozen or so slides, and I don't want this to be my show. I want it to be the dialogue between the attendees and the experts here assembled. Rehabilitation medicine doctor's job is to provide interventions to patients with complex disabling conditions. And of course, you know, I know that 90% of the attendees today are personal injury solicitors, and therefore I expect that your client load is exactly this: people with complex disabling conditions, brain injury, spinal cord injury, and so on. And our focus lies in optimizing recovery following severe injuries and improving function, and thus facilitating participation in society for individuals. So this is where we're getting to those formal definitions of pathology, impairment, ability, participation, and quality of life. We, as rehab physicians, work across that whole piece. Substantially in our particular organization in neurological conditions, but as Julian's very, very well pointed out, this is physical medicine and rehabilitation, physical medicine incorporating other areas of pathology like amputee medicine, like musculoskeletal, and then the separate issue of spinal cord injury medicine, which has found a home of its own rather than being incorporated into neurological rehabilitation. There's a historical reason for that. Okay, next slide, please. So what I'm just going to give you a very quick summary of the roles that we have. And this is not invented from my head. I have drawn very heavily here on the training curriculum for rehabilitation medicine as developed by the Royal College of Physicians. And funnily enough, I thought these points were going to be broken into rather fewer per slide. But anyway, I hope you don't feel kind of overloaded, and please don't try and just read it all. So we have particular skills in the diagnosis, management and prognostication of complex disabilities. And that is a very different thing from most doctors. Most doctors are orientated to a single pathological territory and will become extremely focused on that: cardiology, neurology, gastroenterology. And as Julian has already said, and it's an excellent phrase, we work as the expert generalists, and we are skilled at interpreting multiple symptoms and impairments in differing contexts, social and psychological. And this is really important. We operate in, you'll have heard the phrase, the biopsychosocial model. Biological factors, psychological factors, and social factors all influencing the extent to which an individual experiences the impact of impairment, the impact of the pathology that's caused the impairment. And using that interpretation, we formulate realistic rehabilitation plans that balance the multi-professional input that's required. And you know, good rehabilitation, as you will all know this, is, you know, it's not a single specialty. And I'm certainly not here, and we're not here, to say that medical doctors are the be all and end all of this game. We're definitely not. But I think we are here to say that we do have a very useful contribution to make to the multidisciplinary team, and a contribution that I think, in my experience, is often overlooked. And I think it goes to Julian's point, which I will talk about a bit later, that there is a paucity of rehab physicians. I mean, you've got 1, 2, 3 of us here. I know there are a few of you online watching this. You've probably got 10% of the total rehab physicians in the country on this call. So that's how few we are. I think it's about 180 altogether. and not all full time. So we play a vital role in post-acute care and should be closely involved in that. This is where we were introduced through the rehabilitation prescription. And you know, I had a very good experience of that about 2012 when I was working in Cambridge. I was on the ITU seeing patients one day, sometimes half a day, sometimes a couple of days after really severe injuries, being scraped off the road and so forth. So became an integral part of that acute management team, able to set the individual up for appropriate rehabilitation pathway within the acute care pathway. And it elevated rehabilitation medicine and rehabilitation to be an equal partner with the other clinical specialties, the intensive care specialties, the neurosurgeons, the orthopedic surgeons. That was a really helpful thing for us to be involved in. So we have all the necessary experience of seeing people with brain and cord injury acutely, for example, and following them up long-term to provide expert opinion on causation, condition and prognosis in these type of cases. I think one point I will just make is that oftentimes the courts and indeed solicitors request opinions from neurologists on condition and prognosis and causation in these type of cases. I have done some research into this, and about 5%, so 5% of people with a brain injury ever see a neurologist. In other words, the neurologists don't have a huge experience of brain injury and its rehabilitation and the long-term outcome. About 2% of spinal cord injured patients ever see a neurologist. So fundamentally, it is a misconception that neurologists are the people to turn to for condition causation, condition and prognosis reporting as experts. They, and many of them will completely agree this, they simply don't have the long-term experience to be able to prognosticate about follow-up. And they certainly can't advise on the specialty of rehabilitation. Okay, next slide, please. So I've just talked about that, haven't I? I've said that there are different areas of work. and this is the slide that says how few rehabilitation doctors, rehab consultants there are per 100,000 people. Look at those other numbers, 2 per 100, so that's 10 times as many per head of capita in Germany, almost 4 times as many in Italy, 3 times as many. We are hugely under-resourced. And to Julian's point in our earlier dialogue pre the webinar, it's no wonder that you struggle to get hold of somebody to get active on your individual cases for your clients, and in addition to getting medical legal expertise. We are trying very hard to advance that, but you know, we're still struggling. Okay, next slide, please. I'm just going to give you, this is a really crude, quick overview. And in many ways, what I'm doing here is I'm holding up the flag for the expertise that you are getting when you engage with one of us. So typically, we've done 5 years at medical school, in which we are schooled in the basic sciences, the pathologies of anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, the basics of how the human body works. We're then exposed to pathology on how that influences anatomy, physiology, and biochemistry. So we have a core scientific understanding of why things go wrong with people. Now that is different, and in quantum, very different from most other clinical specialties. Many will touch upon that, but to my experience, understanding, none touches on it with the same degree of focus and time spent as medical doctors. So that's important. By the time you get a rehabilitation consultant, they have been through this process, a couple of years as a foundation trainee, perhaps 3 years in core medical training in one of those disciplines. So we've got things like internal medicine or surgical training, general practice, which is my background, even obs and gyne, which I find quite strange. But anyway, you can get into rehab medicine having done your core training in any of these disciplines. Psychiatry, of course, a very relevant and important discipline. You're then selected, and then you do a minimum of 4 years specific training, high professional training, rehabilitation medicine. So by the time you get somebody who's got the consultant badge, they've got 7, 9, 14 years they've been in and around how the body works and what goes wrong. And then, of course, you're only really engaging with people who've been at it for a few years. So typically, your average medical expert in rehabilitation medicine has probably been a consultant for 5 to 10 years, really got their feet under the table, and they have been around this for 25 years. Okay, so that's really important. This is not something that you just say, actually, I'm a rehab specialist. There's a very clear pathway to becoming a GMC registered specialist in rehabilitation medicine. Okay, thanks. Next slide, please. A couple of other quickies. There are some new nice guidelines published on the 18th of January talking about rehabilitation after traumatic injury. This is a commend it to you. It's an excellent document, actually. And one of the headlines is, of course, that the improvements in survival rates have led to an increase in the need for rehabilitation, which, if you think back to my prior slide, is even more of a problem. There's even more demand on our limited skills. And of course, COVID, and I'm not going to go into that now, but COVID has made a huge impact because a lot of people have developed long-term chronic problems and rehabilitation is required for them and advice for them. And so that has complicated the picture. This is a comprehensive document, great aspirations for what good rehabilitation should look like, and the reality of how you achieve this. Of course, the reality is that achieving it's extremely difficult, as we are finding in Somerset, where we are currently restructuring our service and trying to get more resources in to provide something comprehensive for the people of Somerset. This document refers to an earlier clinical guideline from 2019 on head injury assessment and early management. These two, I really commend to you, they're fascinating. The part of the reason is a slightly self-serving advert there. They are very clear about the contribution of medicine alongside the other professions, neuropsychology, clinical psychology, psychiatry, physio, OT, speech therapy, rehab assistant, nursing, all those things very relevant, very important for a good, well-balanced team, social work, of course, as well. Okay, next slide, please. So our responsibilities are to formulate a full rehabilitation analysis of any clinical problem presented. And that's the key, this is the generalist bit, to include both disease-related and disability-related factors for any patient, no matter their age, condition, or complexity. It's a very broad church, this, and that's why you need to do specialist training in this area, because it is not something that conventional medical specialties are trained to do. They just don't approach the patient or the situation in the same way. That's not strictly true. I mean, psychiatrists are perhaps one group who are orientated rather more this way, and general practitioners to some extent. But anyway, they are not necessarily focusing on the specialist pathologies that we are, you know, brain injury, cord injury, exactly, for example. We need to be able to set out a rehabilitation plan for any new patient with a disability, extending beyond our own specific service. As I've already said, the multidisciplinary team is paramount here, but we've got to be able to work as a full and equal member of that. And I think that because of the low numbers of rehab physicians, we have oftentimes been overlooked, and therefore the important medical contribution to a patient's management is suboptimal. I see this all the time. I'm sure my colleagues will agree with me, but it doesn't seem to be getting any better yet. And we also have got to be able to identify and set priorities within a rehabilitation plan, because there's a million things to do, but actually there is a hierarchy there, and you've got to get the basics right. Next slide, please. Diagnose and manage existing new medical problems in rehabilitation context. So that rests on our medical skills, our diagnostic skills, our awareness of broad pathologies like infection and so forth. We need to recognize the need for and deliver successfully specific medical rehabilitation treatments, botulinum toxin injection, and so forth. We've got to be able to work in any setting, and this is directly relevant to our context today, isn't it? You know, it's all very well having hospitals or clinics in which you can work. It's nice and straightforward. Actually, the majority of patients are out in their homes, and many of your clients are out in their homes. And so we need to be able to get out there in the community and feel equally comfortable working there, and to collaborate with the other teams that are out there in the community, either general practitioners and their teams or hospital specialty teams. But we are a we are a glue that brings all of the medical community together to the benefit of an individual patient and their rehabilitation. And then finally, we need to be able to make and justify decisions in the face of many clinical, sociocultural, and prognostic and ethical and legal uncertainties and the influences that arise in complex cases. So I take this as a big responsibility. I know that my two colleagues on screen also do from rehab medicine. Okay, next slide, please. So this is just a very quick statement that at NRC Medical Experts, we also have a clinical practice service. It's trying to provide that medical expertise in rehabilitation medicine for cases that you have in litigation during their litigation, so the ongoing rehabilitation, and also, of course, once settlement has been achieved. I don't want to labour this point, but there is a service here. This is what we do. I'm not going to read them out. So next slide, please. So really, what I'd like you to do now is take part. Let us have some question and answers. Have your say through the chat dialogue, and I can then chair a discussion between my colleagues. Particularly interested to hear Anna Watkiss's view on the role of the rehabilitation physician in a rehabilitation team that she will case manage. And also, I'm very keen to tease out the distinction between case management expertise and rehabilitation medicine expertise. And I ought to just have a slight declaration of interest here. between 2001 and 2010, I built and ran a case management company called Kynexa. And so I'm not an entire novice in case management and what it is and what it isn't, but I don't want to give my views. I want to hear from an expert in case management, as I hope we all do. So there we are. Thank you very much. Any questions starting us off? Now, Kate, I can't see the dialogue box. What am I doing wrong?
That's okay. We'll go to the panel first, Ed. We're just waiting for some questions to come in.
All right, fine. We're waiting for some questions. So let's go to, well, Anna, would you like to kick us off? You know, I've talked a lot about my own professional angle. Would you like to give us your perspective on that from your long experience, 28 years, as I will remember forever, 28 years experience in and around clinical psychology and then latterly case management?
I should clarify to start with, I am not a chartered clinical psychologist. Just so that you're aware of that, because I haven't practiced as a clinical psychologist.
Okay.
I think that the majority of my experience of working with rehab consultants has been where they have been in charge of a rehab unit. I'm actually just wondering, as we're talking, is that something that happens across the UK, or is that, because I'm based in Edinburgh, so the Scottish brain injury rehab units generally have a rehab consultant who will run that unit, whether that's this, you know, some very well established units around the country, you know, in Edinburgh, in Dundee, over in Glasgow and down in Ayrshire, where I know the rehab consultants working there. Is that, before I go any further, is that the case across England as well?
Yeah. Well, look, I'm not going to give all the answers. Julian, why don't you chip in there, please? Julian's extremely experienced.
I used to run the Frank Cooksey Rehabilitation Unit, which is the level 2A unit at King's College Hospital. And I had another gig at Guy's and St Thomas's in that patient capacity. But the answer to your question is that the rehab units in the UK, and but particularly in England and Wales, are assigned a level on the basis of their complexity, both of provision and of patients. And it goes from level 1 through 2A, 2B, and then down to 3. To qualify for NHS England funding, because these are NHS England funded units, the specialist units, then the service has to meet a very particular service specification. It's about a page long, but it clearly specifies that the unit must be run by a consultant in rehabilitation medicine. Now, there are a couple of exceptions where a neuropsychologist has that role, but those are unusual. And they generally, in those circumstances, are supported by two or three other medical doctors on the ward, on ward rounds, for example. But so now to answer your question, yeah, a rehab medicine consultant has to be in that role. And trusts learn that to their cost. The rehab medicine consultant, for whatever reason, decides to set themselves up in private practice in Harley Street, because that unit then is no longer qualifies for the very large amount of money that the NHS England's funding provides. I mean, I've got, we all complain about, it actually doesn't really cover the costs, but £700 per patient per day is quite a big sack of cash for a unit to lose if they can't retain their rehab medicine consultant.
And that, thank you, Julian, that's really helpful. And of course, there's a very interesting point. We've seen that actually happen in Somerset. It really does happen. So Anna, to your point, rehab consultants are in the units, but many of us are also out in the community as well, or are involved in community services. I mean, Inam will probably be able to say something about that, Inam.
So I guess one of the things that I found really valuable from rehab consultants when working as a case manager is that they will see the clients, as we would say, individuals who've sustained acquired brain injury, they'll see them across their lifetime. And that's where I see that as very useful. So the units all have lifelong referral policies up here. And where I think it is really valuable, you're not getting, you referenced earlier a neurologist only seeing 5% of clients. I think that the other point to make about that is that they see them as inpatients. What's very valuable for a case management community team is having someone who does actually know long-term outcomes for people with brain injury. And of course, that's, I think, where, for me, one of the big values that a rehab consultant can add.
Thank you for that, Anna. That's very helpful. Inam, would you like to just say a few words about that?
Yes, that's right. I think so. This is the key point, in the sense is of the transitioning from, say, like the inpatient rehab units into the community. I think so. That's a very, very important point, because the real rehabilitation, to be honest, over long term, is carried out in the community. So obviously, a post-trauma, post whatever the index event, that's obviously important. So everybody knows that, really. The issue which a lot of people, including, for example, commissioners who are not able to pick out, is that what happens to these people, particularly the inverted commas walking wounded, who look all right, who are fine, but they're discharged. And this is quite a common story. This is a very, very common story. They're discharged after receiving the best treatment, which you can actually imagine. But when they're left in the community, there is no really definite concrete plan as to who does what are the goals, who will actually who will help attain the patient, who will help the patient attain those goals, what is the comeback on it, what is the follow-up, how long does it go. I mean, it's the same like typical head injury, which is usually young people. For the next 50 years, they could be dependent for a very, very complex needs assessment. But that is where
I'm going to just cut in on you there, and I did apologize for that in advance. In my chairing role.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to come in there, because we've actually generating some questions now. And I know Ben's been silent so far, but we already have questions which are specifically for Ben. This one is a question for Ben. Do you, as solicitors, work with rehab consultants for your clients?
Yes. I mean, there's two roles here that are relevant. First of all, there's expert roles, providing expert evidence for the court, reporting upon our clients, providing condition and prognosis reports, providing evidence in court, ultimately, if the case goes to trial. The second role is having a rehab consultant on as part of the rehabilitation team around your client. And yes, that is something that we do, and we will work with rehabilitation consultants as part of the team around our clients.
Well, just let me follow up on that. There's another question which has popped up. I don't, am I supposed to say the names of the questioners? Is that appropriate or not?
You, Ed. Yeah.
What?
Up to me. You can go for it.
Claire Howard. Claire Howard has put this one. The other one's an anonymous attendee. In a civil claim, as rehab consultants are so few, would you say it's better to have a medico-legal expert or rehab consultant as part of the treating team? So I think, let me just interpret that question. I think what we're saying there is you've got rehab consultants. Do you want them to be the medical legal expert as well, or just on the treating team?
Yeah, can I jump in on that?
Yeah, please.
My view is you should keep them separate. I appreciate there are limitations with numbers of the consultants, but you want to have that separation for a number of reasons. First of all, you want that separation because you want the rehabilitation consultant involved with the rehabilitation team to have the ability to focus in on only being involved for that patient, for that patient's medical needs. You don't want them to be distracted by having other concerns about reporting to the court. You also want the benefit of having two consultants, if you can get them onto your case, because if you've got, frankly, an expert involved in your case and a rehabilitation consultant involved in your case, and they are both of the same opinion about your particular client,
yeah,
that's giving you extra emphasis for what you're doing. It helps you justifying what you're doing to the court and to the defendants.
Thanks, Ben. That's really helpful. So there are a few more questions coming up now. Let me just rattle through a few. There's many cases don't have a lead consultant, but have a robust MDT. What difference does the consultant make to that existing team? My goodness, that's a barn door.
Yeah.
Julian, let's hear what you think about that, please.
I fly frequently, and I feel very safe at 30,000 feet, knowing that autopilot and current technology is extraordinarily reliable. But at takeoff and landing, I'm reassured that there's a person sitting there with a hat holding onto a joystick should things go sadly wrong. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the very minimum role that a rehab medicine consultant has, is at the initiation of a complicated medical case, which may or may not involve multidisciplinary rehabilitation. And at that stage, a number of investigations and further assessments might be required. And the decisions about those kinds of investigations and things can only be made by a medical doctor.
I think that's an excellent point.
At the end of a client, or when things go sadly wrong, when one of the engines blows, when you hit a flock of birds, it's reassuring to know there's someone who can turn off the autopilot and jump back into the seat and say, no, we really have to do this, this, and this. And you have to have a person who has, and this is, again, the world is an unfair place, but the reality is that sometimes consultants will only talk to other consultants. And you have a consultant who can pick up the phone and make arrangements for further urgent investigations or an admission or a change in medications. And that can only often be done urgently by a consultant. So I think that is one role. That's the very minimum role that the consultant has. Now, because we're so good at getting on with people, we have much better things to do with that as well. So we can coordinate this great team and make sure that everyone's getting along well together and they're working towards goal-driven and time-delineated objectives. Great. That's another role as well. And I think that can be done very well by other people too, but often it's also done very, very well by rehab medicine consultants.
I think, Julian, that's excellent. Thank you very much. I mean, this is a fantastic question, actually, because what it exposes the fact that we as a professional group have not got across what we can contribute widely enough. That's the first thing.
Yeah.
I think it also exposes a fundamental weakness in, certainly from our perspective, and indeed from the guidelines perspective, in the constitution of many multidisciplinary teams, that one is even asking a question like that. So, well, my goodness, it is so fundamental and important, certainly in our view. It's extraordinary that our world of case management and multidisciplinary rehabilitation teams on these complex cases is operating at all without medical involvement of this type. So I think that's a really important point. Let me just, there's a very good question here, which perhaps Inam, you can pick up.
Ed, just before we move on, I know that Dr. Mhai had his hand up just on that last bit, that last point.
Sorry, Inam, did you want to say something about that last point?
Yeah, that's right. I just wanted to sort of add just a couple of points. For example, I fully, I mean, obviously I work with MDTs, but I'm coming in from a very clinical angle, mind you, not at all medical legal. Just an answer to that question. I respect the robustness of the MDT, but my sort of my point is that I would imagine, having worked with MDTs for a number of years, that everybody is coming from their own disciplines, the expertise of their own disciplines. The fundamental difference is if you have a rehab consultant, they will be able to take an overview of any other factors involved, i.e., for example, a medication review might be needed.
You
never know. I mean, I have, we have, all of us have come across where we have looked up patients' medication and have asked them, when did you last see the GP for a proper medication review?
And I'm gonna come in there.
A lot of the time the answer has been that, well, it's a repeat for the last 6 years.
Yeah, I'm gonna come in there, Inam, because I can see Anna nodding. And I think it's terribly important that we take a view from a very experienced case manager on this. So that's one. And Anna, before you go into this, I want to just feed in the next question, which you can also answer perhaps for us or discuss. How does the rehab consultant slot into a case management led case if it's already going? Now, that's a question I know that Inam can deal with because I know he's done exactly that, but it's a question perhaps you can respond to. I know many of these cases are already running. And the question is, if you've got a new resource, how do you get it in? How does it integrate? What does it feel like?
Okay, well, going back to the first question first, if you like, in terms of the value of the rehab consultant into the case management team, I think it's really just repeating what the guys have said. You know, one of the points is where there are particular medical issues that need to be managed for that client. I think there's particular strengths there from having your rehab consultant involved. As they say, they are a rehabilitation generalist, so it is that view across the whole of the rehab and looking at all of the areas, which again is something that a case manager will do in terms of overseeing that. But I think it's very much, you know, you have the input from the medical perspective there for the rehab, and I think that's really valuable. Also, in terms of slotting into a package as it as it's running, I think if you don't have the rehab consultant involved at one point, and I don't think every team needs one, I think it is different clients that will benefit. I don't think every single team that would have an MDT needs a rehab consultant in it. Sorry, there are very specific value to be added by involving a rehab consultant. But as I say, I just don't. So where you have a package running, where you have an MDT, there is very often then a particular need where you go, actually, what we really need here to clarify a particular issue, goals, or around maybe even, as we're saying, some of the medical matters, if there are elements of prosthetics to be involved or pain or spasticity, those are real areas where it's invaluable to have that input.
Just to pick up on that, and so many of the very complex cases, of course, do have many of those issues. And I completely agree with you. I don't know if my colleagues will say this, but of course, not every case needs to have a rehab physician in it all the time. But I think having access to, as required, can be extremely useful. It's a complexity dependent situation. Can I just feed you another question, Anna, while you're on? There's one here that says, can Ben and or Anna comment on the importance of a rehabilitation prescription for a patient at the acute stage? Now, I don't know whether you can comment on that, but I know that certainly we can if you don't feel you want to. Ben, go for it.
Yeah, okay. Well, in theory, I can see them being extremely useful for our cases, but in practice, we don't often see them. They're not often produced, and they're not often referred to. When they are produced, we pay attention to them.
This comes down to the resource limitation of rehabilitation medicine. And the fact that the whole thing didn't ever really take off. It is something that we are producing at NRC Medical Experts. Anna, do you come across the rehab prescription at all? I'd be very
not
surprised
often,
if any of our
if I'm honest,
do.
Not often. No. You know.
There you go. Okay, I think that answers that particular question. There's no point banging on. It's a huge opportunity to get rehabilitation on the right course from the earliest moment. And I think we must try and seize that. Let me just, there's a couple more questions here. How long post-settlement would a rehabilitation consultant typically remain involved with the patient, and how would their role evolve over time? Julian, that's one for you. I know the answer, but what do you think? You're on mute.
Just a couple of things, I think, to set the stage for this one.
Yeah.
I think we need to be clear in this discussion as we go forward, whether we're discussing a rehabilitation medicine consultant who's been appointed as part of, for example, an interim settlement and to participate with a privately appointed team of therapists and possibly other consultants, or whether we're looking at a rehabilitation medicine consultant need, which is identified in the course of assessments, and then the patient is then referred back to the NHS to have regular reviews from a rehabilitation medicine consultant as part of tertiary care NHS facility. Now, they're both rehab medicine consultants. They're both probably the same people in many geographies, but the resource availability is very different in both instances. You can see me next Thursday, but you can see the NHS medicine rehab medicine consultant in about 18 months' time. That's where the difference lies. So let's assume then that we're talking about, just in principle, does a patient have access to a rehab medicine consultant through the NHS? I think that's the first question I generally ask. I think it's important when I've written a report on a patient, and so I've reviewed their progress, I've written a condition and prognosis report for the court, essentially, that if I feel that it's urgently needed that they have a rehab medicine consultant, I say as much in my report. And then I might articulate that separately in a phone call or even a letter to the lawyer saying, you really should get this guy every 6 months to be seen by a rehab medicine consultant, especially spinal injury patients, to use that good example. If they're only being seen by their orthopedic surgeon or by their spinal surgeon, then they're not well served for the reasons that you touched upon earlier. But the bigger question I think we need to ask is, if a patient is to be seen by a rehab medicine consultant in the NHS, and that if that availability is there, for example, if a rehab medicine consultant completed a rehab prescription on their discharge from the tertiary care hospital, and that rehab medicine consultant has seen them since in follow-up, say a few weeks after they were discharged, and that's the right thing to do, and if that has actually happened, then my advice would be, you've got to get in touch with that service and make sure that patient is always followed up by that service, that they're not promised a follow-up that never happens. They're not dropped, they don't move away and no one chases up after them. No, I'll add something to this discussion that is, in my view, a central value of NHS rehab medicine consultancy services. And that is communication, access to the patient's records. Now, I don't work in the NHS anymore, but one of the reasons that I was unhappy working within the NHS was that I felt that the communication, even within trusts, was unreliable, that there would be a breakdown in communication of letters, of referrals, of follow-up, of reappointments, even between trusts. Now, that is improving, and I think people are being seen more robustly now. I think maybe one thing that came from COVID is we are now getting better at communicating with people in the community. Great.
Julian, but let me come in there, Julian. A couple of points you made there fantastically well. The issue of communication, certainly the rehabilitation prescription was intended to be a document that transcended organisational boundaries, it moved with the patient, it should have been the main reference document, and it just never happened. So your point about communication and connection with the medical record is absolutely right. I don't know, Inam, do you agree with that?
Yes, I think that the rehabilitation prescription has been really an ongoing topic with many trusts across the UK, in fact, and it really hasn't taken off as it should have. It is essentially, there are training issues, there are resources issues, there are handing over issues, there are logistical issues, and it's very, very common that a rehab prescription is filled out, say, from a tertiary centre. When you try to pick up what goals were attained about 8 months down the line in the clinic, there is no communication. You actually don't know who was involved and which goals were attained, because you don't get the feedback. So I think that the rehab prescription, if it's to be implemented, it would have to be done by a real vigor, in the sense that somebody takes it on and follows it down to the line, really. I don't think so. You can literally say, okay, we filled out the rehab prescription and here you go. It hasn't worked, actually. Absolutely not. Yeah.
Let me just, there's a couple more questions here. One of these makes me smile, I'm afraid. Does everyone that has suffered a major trauma receive input and treatment from a rehab consultant? Well, I'll tell you what, I almost don't know where to go with this question. I'm going to ask Ben, from his experience in the medical legal field. What's your sense, Ben?
No, absolutely not.
That's the right answer, by the way.
I can say, both as a solicitor specialising in brain and spinal cord injury and as somebody who has involvement with their local Headway group, a charity for brain injury survivors, for those who aren't familiar with it, there's an awful lot of people who have survived brain injury who never get anywhere near a rehab consultant.
Thank you. Anna, have you got a comment on that from your long experience in case management?
It's just the same, really. Not everyone does.
So that's the point. We have a responsibility as a small group of medical specialists to find more efficient ways of delivering what we think we can deliver, and to be energetic about that. And that's partly why we're having this conversation today. Let me. There's another question here. It says, slightly concerning that there is a high demand for rehab because of COVID and recovery rates and so few consultants. What is the NHS doing about this? Well, I mean, my perspective on that is the NHS is panicking about that. It's a really difficult topic. The services are overloaded. The consultants are run ragged. Many of them are retiring early because they're just done in. and, you know, a further load of patients with chronic, often neurological disability arising from COVID is really a huge pressure on the system. I don't know, Inam, have you got any idea about what the NHS is doing about that?
No, at the moment, really, the thing is that, to be fair to the NHS and particularly the rehab aspect of the NHS, is things are still evolving, really. People are still literally learning what is long COVID or what is post-COVID.
Yeah.
What used to be, what it still is in a way, long COVID, post-COVID, but it's still in literally the discovery sort of phase. Services are evolving, but this is going to be a major, major challenge, particularly with the neurological and the cognitive sequelae.
Sorry, apologies for appearing to butt in, but I'm trying to share it. And there's a slight delay on the line, so it makes it seem a bit staccato. I think that's absolutely right. We are still learning about it, but you know, we have a whole raft of different conditions that are pressuring the rehabilitation services, the neurological rehabilitation services, functional medical disorders, for example. And you know, long COVID, of course, has significant pathological basis, but that is just another pressure on top of it. I think the NHS is trying its damnedest to do something constructive about that, but it's a very difficult area. There's a very good point here. Says, hang on, I'll have a drink. It says, for those consultant rehab experts who are instructed in medico-legal matters, what info do you like to see from the solicitor in order to provide a comprehensive opinion? May I just offer a view on that? Actually, I don't need very much, not really, because you're asking me for an opinion. I'm quite used to going and seeing patients without any real preparation, without any background information, access to whatever records might be available. But I would say I like to see them as early as I possibly can, because I can get the process going in a way that I think might be most advantageous to the patient. So I think this is really interesting, because I've been a medical legal expert a long time. And sometimes one gets letters of instruction that run to a dozen pages, 20 pages of tight typescript. And it's great, but actually much of it I don't need. What I need is to be told, what do you want me to tell you? What is it you're asking me? Are you asking me about causation of certain things, condition of prognosis? Are you asking me about specific matters like life expectancy? You know, what do you want to know? There are a number of things I can tell you. And I would counsel solicitors to keep letters of instruction pretty focused, because then it gives us a good starting point, and that's all we need. Julian, why don't you have a go at that one? You're a big medical legal expert. What do you think? Probably different from me.
Just a couple of things. Well, I think your point is well summarized. Good questions result in good answers. If I demand particularly succinct bullet point questions, it demands of the referrer, of the lawyer, the time, the thought to be put into that question. And so I then respect that I have been given a due consideration, and I'll put more effort, more thought into my answers. That's quite straightforward. It doesn't have to run several pages, but as long as the questions are very clear and succinct, then you'll get good answers from us. Yeah. I want to go back to a couple of small things that were touched upon before. In a former life, I ran the post polio clinic for almost 10 years at a guy's in St. Thomas's Hospital. So my eyebrows are still raised when I hear consultants proclaim that long COVID's new. No, it's not. We've had similar post-viral long-term conditions since at least polio. And we know that half the patients who were hit in the polio epidemics wind up with long polio, essentially, post-polio syndrome. And there are so many similarities between the conditions. So we do know how to do it. I'm startled that no one's actually asked anyone at Guy's in St. Thomas's Hospital to really contribute towards program development for long COVID, because we really do know how to do it. And the post-polio syndrome clinic at Thomas's is out of the respiratory medicine clinic where Boris's life was saved. So so many points of complexion here. And
a really interesting point, Julian, about the contribution to the plan for how to deal with the aftermath of COVID. I know that I tried three times to engage with the trusts in Surrey, which is where I actually lived, despite working in Somerset. Couldn't get in. They just couldn't have the dialogue about rehabilitation. And you're absolutely right. There's nothing new under the sun. This is another post-viral condition. Inam, do you want to make a brief comment about that? With that at all?
Yeah, I think that is absolutely right, obviously. I think that the reason why it's taken out the new evolution is because it's a new the diagnosis. This is one of the problems with medicine, is that people go into diagnostic silos, really. Yeah. And I think that is one of the problems. And it's not just with management or managers, it's actually with medics. And that's really the medic's fault, in a way.
And that's really interesting, because what we've been talking about is, as being generalists, the specialist generalist. And so we are the ideal group of medical doctors to take these conditions on.
Yeah.
Because actually we're not in silos. I think that's really part. So that's a great point, Inam. Thank you. Sorry to have interrupted you again, but I just say,
in our specialty, we don't preoccupy ourselves with the minutiae of the diagnostic subdivisions. We just don't do it. It's not important to us. If we are still curious about a particular subclassification of that diagnosis, then I'll bring a neurologist into the room and I'll sit there quiet and listen to the neurologist and I'll try to understand what they're saying. But I'll swear to you that long after that neurologist has gone, the patient is still sitting in the room, none the wiser, asking me the next most important question: well, now what?
Yeah.
Diagnosis, but now what do I do with my life? That was a 5-minute consultation, very valuable to you maybe, but not to me as the patient. I've got 50 years to live with this. What does it mean?
That's a great point, Julian. Thank you. There's a question here by an anonymous attendee. It says, as a group of experts, what are your thoughts on the future of rehabilitation services? Are they improving? My goodness. I mean, what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask Anna there, because we can bang on as physicians. Anna, what's your perspective on that one?
Well, I guess I would know more about community rehabilitation services.
Which is where most patients are.
Yeah, I've got a soapbox about that, but I won't get on it just now.
Well, if you want to, you've only got 5 minutes, but go for it.
No, I guess I can't say they particularly are, because they're so strapped. Waiting list times are so lengthy. It's incredibly difficult to get the resources. And you know, it's not that there aren't the skilled professionals there, that absolutely are. If you can get them, then you know you can get fantastic services. So it's not that the quality of what's available, it's literally what is available, resourcing.
May I just tell you a very half a minute story about what happened in Somerset about 15 years ago. We had a dedicated 24 bedded inpatient neurological rehabilitation unit. It was shut and demolished as part of financial saving strategy, and a car park was built over it. The patients were put into an acute ward alongside neurology patients with half the number of beds. It was a total Horlicks. I went there, and with Inam, we persuaded the trust that this was completely inappropriate, and we removed the patients out to a community hospital, which has got actually the best views any patient could possibly have in the NHS, views of the Quantock Hills. And I'm painting a rather romantic picture there, but it's that kind of thing that has happened to rehabilitation services, which appalls me, and I think is reflected in what Anna says. You know, there are people out there who can do this work, but the system will sometimes just cut a swathe across it because it doesn't see it as a priority. The priority is, you know, heart attacks, cancers, stroke. Okay, that's great, and that is a priority, but my goodness, if you're saving the lives of people, surely you want to ensure they have the optimum quality of life that follows thereafter, and the maximum participation in society, and maximize their abilities. That's what rehabilitation medicine does. Now, we're getting 17:27. What I'm going to do, we haven't got any more questions.
We've got one more question.
We do have one more. Hang on, it says, for those prepping part 35 expert reports, what tends to be your claimant defendant split? My goodness, that's a very specific question. I mean, I'm not sure we can really answer that. We've got two medical legal experts here who do that work, Julian and me. Inam doesn't do that work. My claimant defendant split has been about 90% claimant, 10% defendant, and that's not through any particular prejudice. It's simply those are the instructions I get. But what I would say is that our responsibility, and I take this incredibly seriously, and I know Julian does and Inam does, is to provide an independent view for the court. Because if you do anything other, if you allow yourself to be persuaded either by the claimant's solicitor and their team or the defendant's solicitor and their team, it just doesn't stand up. Because ultimately, you end up in the court of your opposite number. So Julian would be on the side for the defence, me on the... It's patently obvious that you're not doing the right thing. So that's my particular split, but I'm happy to see anybody anytime. Julian, do you want to give a few on that?
I'm about 80-10-10, as in okay. 80 yep. Litigants, about 10% defendant, and about 10% occasionally we're joint appointed, so I'm appointed on both sides. Those are interesting. Yep.
Can I just comment on?
Do
that.
Ben, go on then.
Sorry, I was just going to say. I wouldn't get terribly hung up about an expert who's instructed more often on the claimant side than the defendant side. It doesn't, to my mind, it doesn't mean that that particular expert is perceived as being claimant-minded. The fact of the matter is, defendants don't instruct experts as often as claimants do. And right. Experts are going to be instructed more often by claimants than defendants.
I'm really sure
a big piece of learning that is
from you that that actually is the case, but I kind of figured it out over the past couple of years that that's probably where this is. And so it's not down to it. Back to Ed's point about being entirely impartial and trying to be utterly fair in our reports. One of the very first things I say to all of my clients, even before I take off my coat, is I'm going to write an impartial report. If the people who appointed me don't like it, they won't submit it, but I won't change it. And the day I submit a biased report is the last day of my career.
Yeah, absolutely right. And Ben, thank you so much for that piece of perspective. If any of us have got a takeaway from this meeting, that is my takeaway. That's absolutely brilliant. So look, we've reached 5:30. I think we need to bring the discussion to a conclusion. So I just want to say a great thank you to Anna, to Ben, to Julian and to Inam for taking part. And another thank you to all of you for listening, and I hope taking away some useful messages and for your questions, which have been insightful and interesting. I hope our answers have been helpful. Please do feel free to communicate with us subsequently. Otherwise, I wish you all a good evening. Thank you very much and good night.